Hey everybody, thanks for joining us. Today we're on the Salt Patrol boat out of Westport, Washington, going after summer salmon. And then it's Columbia River American Shad by the bags full. Now stay tuned.
I'm Justin Wolf, and this is Angler West Television.
First light, and we're going salmon fishing.
We're just heading out of the harbor now. We're in Westport Boat Basin. We're going to go around and go over the Gray's Harbor Bar, and then we're going to head north up along the shoreline there, north of Ocean Shores. And we've been fishing out here quite a bit. Last week, we were just about the same place, picked up quite a few fish. There's been a lot of bird life up there. Kings have been running small ones, anywhere from 12 to 15, and the biggest we got so far is about 25 pounds. And then we've done well on coho by running just outside there in about 180 feet of water. And there's been some nice schools of coho swimming out there, but been a ton of bait in the area. So looking forward to it. Should be a good day today.
Westport is known for its excellent salmon fishing. And today we're with Tony Dobson and Doug Hayes. We're fishing with John Keizer of Salt Patrol.
So it looks like it's pretty flat out here today. What's the forecast?
Flat and sunny. It looks like swell was like 3 feet at 14 seconds. Should be nothing. There's no runoff today, so we should be having a real flat bar crossing.
We're gonna go ahead and put two riggers out and two divers out. Run the riggers a little deeper, run the divers on top. And we're gonna be trolling in between the crab pot lines here. That's where the fish are at. We're in about 40 feet of water, 45 feet of water. We're kinda, it's what we call the skinny water. But that's where the kings have been. They've been coming down along the coastline here. And you'll get them either on top or towards the bottom, so it can go either way. So what we do is on the shallow stuff here, we like to run a couple divers. It's just a release mechanism on the diver right behind it. We'll go ahead and run a flasher attached directly to it. And then we just come down, give it about 4 to 5 feet a leader. We'll come down to our herring, which is brined up. It's got a little bit of chartreuse coloring on it, so it gives it a good flash in the water. We like to troll here about 2 miles an hour to 2.5. These fish out here are pretty active feeders, so having just a little bit more speed. What I like to do is look at my rigger and get a little bit of angle on it, and that kind of gives me a good indication of where I'm supposed to be. So it's, you got to judge a little bit different in the shallow water because the riggers aren't down very far. We're fishing basically 35, 30, and then two divers on top of the water. So we're marking a few fish down here. As you can see, it's 48 feet deep. And about 40 feet here, we got a line, and we're just off Capella's Head, which is just north of Westport right here. So that's kind of where we're fishing at. And we're going to turn and go a little bit north here, try to stay out of the crab pots. And these are fish right here, so looks like we're in a good spot. Just got to get them to go. So, Doug, we're about an hour before the tide change.
Right.
So normally what happens is we'll be to high water on this next tide change at 7 o'clock. So we'll usually see the fish bite about, you know, anywhere a half hour after that. Seems like that's when they like to turn on. They get that slack water, and as soon as the water starts moving again, boom, we seem to get a bite going then.
Yeah, there seems to be a lot of bait fish in here right now. So.
Oh yeah, well, we're marking fish. I think we're in a good spot. We got bait. It's salmon don't bite all day, man.
That's it.
They're like guys, you know, if you put a donut on a table, they'll just walk over and grab it, right?
Sure.
If you put it at the top of a ladder, they're probably not gonna go get it. Salmon are the same way. They don't like to fight current. So right. As soon as the tide goes slack, that's when they like to feed, so that they go on a bite. Okay, we just hooked up. He figured out he was hooked. Like it.
Yeah, just like you were saying earlier, you know, as soon as that tide changed, right about 7:20.
Yeah, as soon as that water starts moving again, fish go on the bite. So, there, he's coming up. Yeah, these barbless hooks, you just got to keep steady pressure on them, son. Out here this time of year, Doug, you can keep one coho, one king, and it can be clipped or non-clipped, so it doesn't really matter. If it's a Chinook, and it obviously is. So. Right. Little one. Reach too far. There you go. Good job.
All right, nice fishing.
All right, we go, man. Right, yeah. First one. Nice to get that first one in the boat.
Guys. No adipose here, so. Beautiful fish.
The city of Westport is a great small town with lots going on besides fishing. A perfect place to moor your boat or spend the day shopping and sightseeing. While in Westport, stay at the Westport Inn, conveniently located next to the Westport Boat Basin and a great beach. Go to westportwamotel.com for more information. Welcome back to the Washington coast, just north of Westport. I'm Justin Wolf. John Keizer of Salt Patrol, who's fishing with Tony Dobson and Doug Hayes, has the first Chinook of the day in the boat.
All right, we're going to switch this lure out to a wiggle hoochie, and you got to take the barbs off of it. $100 a barb if you get caught, and so you just take your pliers here, crimp it down, and if it's smooth, you're good to go. You don't want anything keeping it from coming out. So we're gonna put this onto a 10'6" downrigger rod, and you want that longer rod with that softer tip. That way you get that shock absorber in there, and you'll lose less fish. A little Deadly Duncan from Proke here. And we'll take it and squirt it up inside the skirt here. A little on the outside.
Hey Doug, we got a bunch of commercial crab pots here. We got them on both sides of us, and we're trolling through a lane here. So you got to kind of watch you don't get in, and we call it dancing with the devil because you're messing with these pots. But these pots actually hold a lot of fish. There'll be bait schools around the pots themselves, so you get in there. So we try to troll close to them, but not close enough to hang up. And if you get close to one, you want to get your gear up right away. So somebody just yells crab pot, get everything pulled out of the water immediately, and away we go.
We go ahead and drop down the school of fish right in here.
Despite the favorable early morning conditions, we did experience a significant lull in the action for a few hours, but finally the birds told us to get ready.
And so we got a big bait ball we're just going by right here. That was fisher targeting this. That's what the birds were diving on. It popped up on the surface. So something's pushing it up those. Hopefully we can get something going here. Diving right in front of the boat here. Watch the rods.
Nice on top of the water. Had that school of fish back there. He just hammered it. Got these barbless hooks, so you gotta kinda keep a little bit of tension on him.
All right, good job. Man, he just smoked that thing.
Yeah, he did.
He freaked hard.
If you look out there, you can see that school of fish kinda glittering a little bit out there. Got this new Lima glass. Keen Eye Quick, it's one of their new rods they come out with. Nice downrigger rod, it's got a good soft tip, good bend over at the tip, but still right back in here, nice and firm. You really lay into them a little bit if you need to.
Just rebaited that sucker a minute ago.
Did he?
Yeah.
Yeah, I just put it back
in. All right, I was sleeping, huh?
Yeah.
Nice fish.
Yeah, it is.
Yeah,
it's a nice fish.
That's a good king there.
Yeah. Hate it when the head shake like
yeah,
that.
Yeah, best thing to do that. Is bury your tip in the water
yeah.
if you can.
We're gonna dive down a little bit now.
Good. We like them.
Yeah.
We like them wore out.
Get them tired. You don't land on their side when they come up.
It's a good fish.
Yeah, he's probably 22.
Yeah, maybe. Hard to tell. Always hard to tell in the water.
Yeah,
take a little closer.
Down
and
lift
him
up.
Got
the rod 9'6".
Not quite yet.
He didn't like the way that net looked, did he?
Oh, sorry, Doug. Gave him a little tickle. Okay. Yeah, these ocean fish, man, they got a lot of energy. Well, that's a nice fish. That'll go over 20. Nice.
Right on. There you go.
Good job. Oh, that's a nice fish.
Oh, it's a beauty.
Oh, that's a nice. That's a good Westport King
that's
there.
That's a little bigger than I thought in the water there.
Yeah, that's a good one.
He's a beauty.
Hey. It's about 26.
Yeah. That white belly on him.
Was that worth the wait?
Yeah.
It's been a slow day, but you know, that makes it a little bit better.
That makes it a little better.
Yeah. So we got a really nice 26 pounder. Right when we got to the net, it broke that trailing hook off. So we're gonna go ahead and cut this off, and we're using 25 pound P-line. We can go ahead and cut this off and rebait up.
Ooh, crab butt.
John!
What?
Fish!
Okay.
Which one? Downrigger.
Okay, go ahead. You got it, buddy.
I think it's a small one.
Alright.
Ready? He's not.
Not clipped?
Not
no,
ready. No, not ready.
No. I see a fin.
He's a native.
Okay, I see a fin. So we're gonna do a release.
Got to release a native coho out here, but you can retain any king. One king per person.
Okay, so the best way to release these fish, if they're not hooked up too bad, if they're really bad, cut them loose, but what we're gonna try and do is pop these hooks out. I got one. So we just kind of use a reverse motion, get them right in the bend, just pick them up, give the fish a little tap, and away he's gone. I don't even like to touch them. So if you rub the skin off them, the slime off them, they can get a disease, you know, so this way they're gonna grow bigger and we'll catch them later.
Special thanks to John Keizer and Salt Patrol. Learn more about Salt Patrol at saltpatrol.com. The city of Westport is a great small town with lots going on besides fishing. A perfect place to moor your boat or spend the day shopping and sightseeing. While in Westport, stay at the Westport Inn, conveniently located next to the Westport Boat Basin and a great beach. Go to westportwamotel.com for more information.
That's what I like. 15 seconds of fishing.
Last night, over 90,000 shad swam through Bonneville Dam on the lower Columbia River. And today, we're anchored up just below Bonneville in what's known as the Shad Rack. Nice.
Very nice.
We're here very long, got one boat. It's all about shad fishing, lots of action.
This year, limits have been lifted on this non-native species that is especially plentiful.
Easiest way to grab them is right in the gills. They don't flop around and get away from you. This here's on a Dick Knight we're using, red and chrome. Never know what color that they want, so sometimes you gotta experiment with some different colors and find out which one they want, and when you find it, then usually you can do pretty good. So this is number one of a couple hundred that we need today.
Now, you're allowed 25 a person?
No limit.
No limit, oh, okay, right on.
Steve Lynch of Procure has brought his son James and son-in-law Matt Fleming out to fish with guide Steve Leonard, who's stocking up on shad to use as bait for the year's fishing and crabbing.
Don't step back.
There we go. That rod's getting hit, but it's not sticking.
Okay, we're out here fishing the Columbia River today for these shad. They're migrating up the river for a couple of reasons. I like to use them for sturgeon bait. We use them for a big trophy oversized fish. It's a great bait that we target them with. Also, we use them for crabbing on the Columbia or the ocean, out in the bays on the Oregon coast. They work really, really good for that. We've also used them for halibut bait also at times when we go out halibut fishing. But we're getting about 30,000 a day coming through here, and there'll be over a million that'll come through here in about a 3-week period.
We looked it up last night, and there was just over 94,000 that went over Bonneville yesterday. So, pretty good numbers. We're just looking for a couple hundred.
You take that one? Yeah. And if you have kids that want to go fishing, you know, like trout fishing type stuff, this is a great way to take them out 3 or 4 hours, catch them a bunch of fish, a lot of action. It's great for them. They don't get bored because you can tell we've had doubles on and nonstop action, especially when you're in them for that depth of water that they're running in and you got the right lure out there. This shad here is a male. It's a smaller in size. As you can tell, this probably only weighs maybe a pound and a half or somewhere right in there. Then you get your big females. They weigh up to almost 5 pounds. I think the state record is like 8 or something like that. But these are the perfect size that we like for doing our crab bait and for our sturgeon fishery. Sometimes those big females are good for crab bait, but the sturgeon don't like them as well because they're too big. But this is a really good average size American shad right here.
I put that shrimp on this rod. Seems to be the one they like. As soon as I put on the shrimp krill, the two rods we got it on, I've produced almost all the fish. And I think it's because primarily these fish are plankton eaters. So the shrimp, the krill are just great sense to use for.
Come on, get over here. There you go.
So Steve, what do you do with these when you get them home?
I'll take them. I'll usually put them in like 3 to a pack for the size that I use for sturgeon bait or if I want to do some crab bait. If I'm going to be crabbing, I usually will cut them in half or my leftovers I use for my sturgeon fisheries that I don't catch sturgeon on, I'll cut them in half in the chunk size I want for my bait boxes, and then I'll just put them in bags and freeze them for the sizes that I need. But I don't really gut them, anything like that. Some people do eat them. They're not my favorite fish. I've had them pickled, but that's it. So if you do eat them, people bleed them out to get the blood out of them, and then you can gut them and clean them out if you are going to go home and can them. But pressure cooking them is probably the best way. People put a little bit of salt in this, and vinegar will help dissolve the bones when you do the pressure cooking, so there'll be no bones when you go to eat it. It definitely has a real fishy flavor to it, and some people like that.
Hey.
Welcome back to the Shad Rack on the Lower Columbia River. I'm Justin Wolf. We're helping guide Steve Leonard catch several hundred shad for the year's stockpile of bait. And at the rate we're going, we'll be done before lunch.
So that's a female, right? Because a little bigger?
See how big this one is, how fat it is? Definitely a female there. Let me grab this one out of your way, Steve.
Yeah, I just loaded that one up too.
Oh, we're over here, way over here on the other side. These fish will come through in school, so you'll have a period where you won't get bit. Usually it's not very long, but when they do come through, you can have doubles and triples on, so it's a lot of fun. Definitely get some action out here. So you can use different types of rods. I'm using Lamaglass rods here. This one here is an XCC 801. We use it for the steelhead rod, basically, for plugging for steelhead we use on the smaller rivers or in the Columbia here. Has a real nice fast action tip to it with a backbone to it. So there's a lot of fun out here. I run my diver rods or even lead rods with line counters with this particular setup. So as you can see what we have here, we haven't been here an hour. Probably somewhere in there. I'd have to say there's at least 50 of them in this bag. So I just got a bigger cooler up on the bow of the boat, some ice in them. These fish will spoil quickly. I mean, within a day or so, we like to keep them on ice, keep them fresh. It's always good. So I just use a smaller cooler, makes it easier for keeping them contained instead of having them flopping all over the boat. And I'll just throw them in a bigger cooler up on the bow here. I'll just put them on some ice. Okay, this particular one here we caught on a new lure called a Baby Simon. It's a real small type of spoon. They use them a lot for kokanee fishing. We use a larger version of it for salmon fishing on the Columbia River. It's just a smaller one they came out with, and we just tried to put it on the line here. We got our first shad on it, so it's working. I'll show you a little bit about the terminal tackle that we're using here in the setup. There's a couple different ways you can do it. With the lead that I'm using, I like to use a spreader bar. They call these a spreader bar. They got a swivel on them on each end. Just kind of helps keep everything untangled. Using about a 2-foot drop for the lead line, using 3-foot for the lure. Pretty standard, works very well. Sometimes if you're not getting bit, if your rod's back farther and you're getting bit, it's because the lure's closer to the bottom, you can shorten up your lead line or you can lengthen it just to find out where it needs to be.
real simple. I'm just putting a loop on the end of this leader line here to loop the lead on. You can put a snap swivel here if you like. Just very basic setup that we're using here today.
Okay, this particular rig we got here is what we use with the diver. You can use different types of divers. This is actually a Lure Jensen number 10, they call it. So it'll dive down to 10 feet with like 100 feet of line out. But we're not running that much out. We're running only like 30, 40 feet. I have it on a slider. Just works very well because I can also run lead on it if I want. So I just clip it on there. Just a standard swivel, a little bead in between it. Then a little bead chain. Just so if there's any twisting in the lures, it's working out there that you don't get no twist in your line. Run about a 5 foot section of line here, 12 pound test, monofilament to the Dick Knight spoon, whatever type of spoon you're using, the Simon or whatever your favorite lures that you're running. So it's a very basic setup right here. Running the, there's different settings on the diver. I'm running for the deep setting, this is the very top. But if you want to go shallower, you can move it down on the holes here on the diver. So it just depends on how far back you want to go and how deep you want it to run. I'm also running a line counter reel on this, which makes it very nice for how far out you're going. It's an ambassador reel with a line counter on it, but it's we run it out till we start at zero, and then we'll run out to 30, 40 feet, click the reel, so it works very well. And that's XCC 801 graphite handled rod, laminglass rod, that works very well for these divers and these shad that we're catching today.
Here's another one on the baby Simon. Take that! Four, two, four. Bag number four.
Today's episode of Angler West TV. You know, it's only with the sponsor support that this show is made possible, so please thank them when you can. Now get out there and do some great fishing.